Professor of Medicine at Weill Cornell Medical Center, health editor of Parade Magazine. Also joining us, of course, my colleague, Eric Shawn. Good morning to you.
Hello,
good morning
everybody.
To you. And I am so excited about this first topic because this is something my friends and I actually talk a lot about. This week, the Food and Drug Administration lifted its 14-year ban on silicone breast implants due to safety concerns. But it came with several conditions and warnings, including a requirement that manufacturers tell women these are not for life. Well, doctor, what else should women know about these silicone breast implants?
You know, women get these implants for two major reasons. First, after breast surgery, have reconstruction. And second, for cosmetic reasons. Some women don't think their breasts aren't large enough and do it for improve their appearance. And these silicone implants have been banned for the last 14 years. The reason was there was a belief among many people, among many doctors, a lot of them credible, and who still maintain the position that the leaking that may occur from the silicone can cause various forms of rheumatoid arthritis, can cause cancer, can cause other problems. This latest study, on the basis of which the FDA has approved these silicone implants, indicates that this is not the case. There is no evidence that these silicone implants are dangerous. But I think you should know, before you decide to do it, that the silicone implants, when you say are not for life, chances are almost certainly that you will have to have another operation, either to have them removed or correct a leak or so on. Also, once you have the implant, you have to have an MRI in 3 years and then one regularly to make sure that the silicone is not leaking. The leaking can cause all kinds of problems. They're not a threat to your life, but they cause hardening of the breast. They cause insensitivity of the nipple. They cause pain. They cause swelling. There's all kinds of potential problems. This FDA ruling did not say that the silicone implant is great. It said it is not dangerous. And if a woman decides, despite all this, to go ahead, it is probably not a threat to her life. I figured out that just doing the MRI at the intervals that are recommended would cost more than having the implant itself.
Oh, brother.
Oh, boy. Well, from some
important... You know, the option is saline implants. Mm-hmm. Now, if they leak, it's just salt water. And it's not, nothing is going to happen. The saline is not, doesn't have the texture, doesn't have the feel of the silicone, but it's completely safe and without really any complications as compared to the silicone. So it's safe, but think twice about it before you do it.
All right, for some important medical news for women, let's go to some important medical news for you men. This is a possible breakthrough in the treatment of prostate cancer. Some new research this week suggests that a blood test that's widely used to screen for the disease can now also predict if it's going to be deadly or not. So, Doc, how unusual is it that a blood test can prove if something could be deadly?
You know, prostate cancer strikes, I think, something like 215,000 men every year, especially men as they get older. Only 30,000 die, and that means that the disease is generally slow-growing and amenable to treatment. Now, it's a very hard disease to diagnose, because unlike enlargement of the prostate, which causes symptoms, having to get up at night very frequently, prostate cancer is silent. And it's also very difficult for the doctor to detect it on a digital physical examination. So you're dealing with a potentially lethal cancer that's hard to find. Now, we have been using for years the PSA blood test. PSA is a protein that is made by cancerous prostate cells. The level of the PSA in the blood is measured. Generally, doctors have recommended that after the age of 50, every man should have a PSA level done every year. And we've given an arbitrary number, four nanograms. If your PSA is four or more, that is suspicious, and if it's five or six, you'll probably end up getting a biopsy. Now, the latest studies show that you should start getting your PSA done in the late 30s or age 40 and then have it done repeatedly, because it's not the absolute number of the PSA, but it's the rate at which the number goes up year after year. And that's why we have found that men with a PSA of 2.6, for example, can have prostate cancer. So what you do is you get the PSA measured in your blood. Then if it's, let's say, 1, if next year it's 1.8, in the following year it's 2.4, you've had a two unit rise, that indicates the possibility of cancer. It also indicates, if there is a rapid rise, that the prostate cancer will be aggressive, that is, apt to spread rapidly. So the bottom line here is this. Don't wait until you're 50 to get a PSA. If you're going for a routine checkup, you're a man going for a routine checkup, ask for the PSA in your late 30s or 40.
Okay. To get a baseline.
Yeah.
Perfect. Okay. The new study by the Agriculture Department suggests that cinnamon extract reduces factors linked to diabetes and other cardiovascular diseases. More than 20 million Americans have diabetes. One out of every three don't know they have it. So, doctor, can spicing up really help your diabetes?
Eric, long before Paige came on the show with us, we talked about cinnamon. I've been talking about cinnamon here for years.
You have been a major proponent of cinnamon.
A major proponent, because early research showed that in diabetics, taking a half a teaspoon of cinnamon powder a day seemed to lower their blood sugar levels. This was confirmed by research done at Johns Hopkins and research centers throughout the world. And over the years, people now have come to accept the fact that cinnamon in diabetics lowers the blood sugar. It does so by increasing the sensitivity of the body to insulin that it produces. Now, the news now is that cinnamon not only protects or reduces the risk of, or the level of sugar in diabetics, but it also protects against heart disease. If people who have the metabolic syndrome, that's a combination of overweight, high blood pressure, diabetes, if these people take cinnamon, they have been found not only to lower their blood sugar, but also to protect them against the onset of cardiovascular disease, heart attack, stroke, and so on. So I'm advising everybody to take some cinnamon, especially if they're overweight and have high blood pressure. Listen, cinnamon can't do you any harm,
no.
A half a teaspoon a day, or taking it in the capsules. Why not?
Why not? And it tastes good.
And it's a lot cheaper than a lot of medications.
Kills your appetite, too, as a diet aid.
Oh, it is.
You're a spicy guy.
Yeah.
How about that? Well, talking about cinnamon and everything else, do you ever miss something that Dr. Rosenfeld says, or do you want to hear it again? Well, you can go to foxnews.com/health, scroll down to Sunday House Call with Dr. Isidore Rosenfeld, and you will get all your favorite House Call segments. There he is at your fingertips to get more on cinnamon and all the other wonderful advice that the doctor spoons out.
That's
every
right.
Sunday at this time.
And kicking the smoking habit, people try all kinds of different things, but is there one best way to do it? Well, Dr. Isidore Rosenfeld answers that coming up.
And we've been telling you about Britney and K-Fed. Well, they're just the latest celebrity breakup. They signed a prenup, but now there are $100 million in play. A lot of dough. Does that protect their assets? And what about your $100 million? We'll take a look. We'll be right back.